I Am the Pretty Thing That Lives in the House is a 2016 film from writer-director Oz Perkins, starring Ruth Wilson, Paula Prentiss, and Bob Balaban. It tells the story of Lily Saylor, a hospice nurse who begins her newest assignment at the house of Iris Blum, a successful horror novelist. Iris is suffering from dementia and living out her remaining days in her house, which may or may not be haunted. In this video, I'd like to talk about how the film blurs the line between the supernatural and the psychological. It begs the question, what haunts us? Hi, I'm Tabari, and this is my take on I Am the Pretty Thing That Lives in the House. I have heard myself say, these opening five words made me so uneasy the first time I watched this. We are given such uncertainty right from the beginning. It raises so many questions, like, who is speaking? To whom? Why are they talking like that? It sounds like someone who was somehow disconnected from their thoughts. Now let's hear the rest. I have heard myself say that a house with a death in it can never again be bought or sold by the living. It can only be borrowed from the ghosts that have stayed behind, to go back and forth, letting out and gathering back in again, worrying over the floors in confused circles, tending to their deaths like patchy, withered gardens. They have stayed to look back for a glimpse of the very last moments of their lives, but the memories of their own deaths are faces on the wrong side of wet windows smeared by rain, impossible to properly see. There is nothing that chains them to the places where the bodies have fallen. They are free to go, but still they can find themselves held in place by their looking. For those who have stayed, their prison is their never seeing, and left alone, this is how they rot. I can be sure of only a very few things. The pretty thing you are looking at is me. Of this, I am sure. My name is Lily Saylor. I am a hospice nurse. 3 days ago, I turned 28 years old. I will never be 29 years old. Yikes. Now, I wanted you to hear that. While I can't say I compare to the film's audio, the point is still made. Now let me ask you, how does she sound to you? She sounds scared, unemotional, maybe a little out of it? This opening monologue sets the tone perfectly and sets up our protagonist as an unreliable narrator. I don't know what to believe from her speech. How can I trust anything she is saying? So we have to choose to trust her. We have to buy in. We have to buy into this state of confusion the film portrays, the same mind state that our protagonist is in, a mind state that creates the environment for some intense suspense, the kind of suspense that slowly builds into the dread that both the audience and our protagonist will endure throughout the film. This is our protagonist, Lily Saylor. While the intro gives us a little bit of information about Lily, we're going to need more. Lily begins her latest job at the house of Iris Blum. Iris Blum is suffering from dementia and living out her remaining life in her estate. When Lily goes to her room to meet Iris for the first time, they both seem terrified of one another. Lily is easily scared, so when Iris turns from the window and gazes at her with a face twisted in horror, she has a hard time not showing how scared she is. On the first night, she explores the house. Finding the phone, Lily makes a call to her friend. Through this, we learn that Lily has had a recent breakup with her fiance. We see a bit of how timid she is. During the phone call, an invisible force yanks the phone out of her hand and scares her. This is the first of many scares that Lily will have to endure while living in this potentially haunted house. Later that same night, she is startled by Iris after she wanders downstairs. As Lily puts her to bed, Iris insists that she is someone named Polly, no matter what Lily says. 11 months pass like the night, and by now, Lily has settled into her isolation. She has named each of the flowers, even going as far as to speak to them. She has gotten used to straightening the corner of the rug at the end of the stairs, which keeps getting turned over somehow, even though no one else should be walking around the house. Now, I believe this to be a red herring. My first time watching it, I thought Lily would trip on this and die somehow. Maybe she would be running from something that scared her and trip on the rug and die. Now, that doesn't exactly happen, but she does die in that same spot later. While speaking to the flowers, she hears him say, "This is how you rot." She looks a bit nervous but shrugs it off. This makes me wonder how often things like this have happened since she has been in this house. Has she had anything like this happen to her before coming here? She seems to just take it in stride. Or is this just how she copes? Later, when she sees her arms become bloated and blackened, she kind of just shrugs it off again. When Iris calls her, she just runs away and is never brought up again. None of these potential hallucinations change how she behaves. It reinforces the idea that Lily is not a reliable narrator. In her opening monologue, she states she can only be sure of a very few things, so how much can we actually trust? She doesn't trust herself when she sees these potentially supernatural phenomena. She believes she is just being a scaredy cat, that she's being ridiculous. Now she is practically sobbing after reading the intro of The Lady in the Walls by Iris Blum, which is a story within a story that parallels Lily's own journey. So if she feels that she's being silly when she's being scared, she never validates her own feelings of being scared. Her constant state of terror leads me to believe that this film is more about mental illness than ghosts. Iris is suffering from dementia. Polly's husband kills her violently, likely due to his own mental health issues. Lily is now, or has been, suffering from some kind of trauma. Living in this house that scares her so much has most likely deteriorated her mental health, possibly to the point of developing some kind of psychosis. Psychosis is a mental disorder characterized by a disconnection from reality. The National Alliance of Mental Illness says, quote, "Early warning signs include the following: suspiciousness or uneasiness with others. It also includes spending a lot more time alone than usual," end quote. When discussing the signs of early or first episode psychosis, they say, quote, "Determining exactly when the first episode of psychosis begins can be hard, but these signs and symptoms strongly indicate an episode of psychosis. Hearing, seeing, tasting, or believing things that others don't. Persistent, unusual thoughts or beliefs that can't be set aside regardless of what others believe. Withdrawing from family and friends," end quote. Definitely not claiming to be a trained mental health professional. I do see a few of these traits in Lily, and they could be seen as symptoms of a more serious illness. It's mainly the advent of her hallucinations and how often she talks to herself that makes me think this. We see Lily slap her own hand as she starts to snoop and tells herself to stop. She talks to inanimate objects like the television and the flowers. We already know that she may be having visual hallucinations, but she also has had what could be seen as auditory hallucinations, like the nail dropping or hearing, "This is how you rot." After watching her own arms become bloated, she really just shakes it off. How could someone see themselves rot and shrug it off so easily? So if she had any latent mental health issues that may or may not have contributed to the breakup, the 11 months she spends in that house will make her condition worsen. Spending every night in that house has had a profound effect on her, making it harder to heal. The mold grows in the house like the fear growing in Lily. I believe that her past experiences have laid the groundwork for her susceptibility to developing her possible psychosis. Her timid and jumpy demeanor is what makes her so greatly affected by the spookiness of the house. It is further amplified by the solitude she has been in for the past year. Although she lives with Iris, she can't exactly socialize with her. Iris isn't even capable of understanding that Lily is not Polly. In a scene where Lily is grooming Iris, she tries to convince her she is not Polly by reciting her address as if she is a lost child. Before she can even finish, she falters. I wonder what that memory was. Was it the house where she lived with her fiancé? Maybe her childhood home? Could it be some past trauma? There has been mold growing on the wall over the past year in the downstairs hallway. We learn that this is the final resting place of Polly. It's where her husband hit her in the wall. When Lily wanders downstairs and sees that the wall isn't open, I think this symbolizes how bad her mental state has gotten. Pandora's box has been opened. Lily, who is investigating the noise she heard downstairs, is scared to death by Polly's ghost. In death, Lily becomes responsible for the haunting of this home. We see her potentially haunting Iris in the past. Maybe Lily was Polly the entire time. We can't really be sure because time appears to behave differently for the dead. This constant state of confusion in this film effectively mirrors the mind state of someone who is mentally ill. There are very few, if any, real certainties to hold on to. My own mental health journey included prolonged states of confusion, constantly questioning myself. I was always unsure of who or what to trust, what to believe in. Not even being able to trust oneself, your own judgment, is a terrible existence. We cannot be healthy with little to no certainty in our lives. An extreme example of this is the dementia that Iris suffers from. She is unable to recognize Lily as who she is and is incapable of caring for herself. Now imagine you have some other mental health issue and you can't really tell what it is. People around you may or may not even believe you. Or perhaps they are incapable of understanding that your mind isn't healthy and needs professional counseling. That's got to be so hard. I feel the same way about addiction. In Earl Sweatshirt's song, Grief, he says, quote, "Step into the shadows, we can talk addiction. Where it's harmful where you going, but the part of you that know it don't give a fuck. Part of me for going into detail," end quote. Earl's own struggles with drugs and alcohol is what led him to write that line. Addiction is a compulsion that goes against our better judgment. Addicts have the self-awareness to know what they're doing is self-destructive, but the idea of not having that high to numb or drive away the negative emotions is much stronger. At least it's a break from the suffering. This film can be seen as a way to empathize with those having a difficult time maintaining a healthy mind. We must all do what we can to maintain our physical, mental, and spiritual health. A big part of that journey is empathy. Empathy is described as, quote, "the capacity to understand or feel what another person is experiencing from within their frame of reference. That is, the capacity to place oneself in another's position," end quote. Art allows us to experience varied frames of reference, allowing us to view the world through the eyes of another. This film does that by showing us what it's like in the mind of someone who feels they are dead already. Lily is incredibly timid and frail. We can only make assumptions as to why, but that's not really the point. We shouldn't need to know all the nasty details as to how and why she is suffering to feel empathy for her. This person is suffering, and that should be enough. If we can be more empathetic to one another without the need for so many qualifiers, maybe we can save more people from experiencing such a hellish existence. Maybe you can save yourself from fighting your own mind, grasping in vain for thoughts like smoke as you slowly fade into oblivion. This film is amazing. I really love this film. It creeped me out in a way that I haven't been in a while. The tone of this film is one of ever-building dread from beginning to end. Those opening shots of Polly walking in slow motion, which is ultra creepy once you realize that she's walking backwards. Later, there's the one where there's a ghost looking like he's eating something, but we learn that it was just Lily on the phone. Bruh. The small lens snooping in the house in the night. Now add that with the narration of Ruth Wilson, her voice would be pleasant if it wasn't so unnerving. She speaks with almost no emotion, and her voice tends to distort. This film is less scary as it is suspenseful as hell. The cinematography and direction are absolutely perfect for the tone of this film. Perkin uses empty space in a way that lends itself to the suspense. There are so many spooky shots in this film. I mean, look at this. The acting, right on. Ruth Wilson plays Lily so well. She looks so fragile and vulnerable, she's almost shaking in every scene. When she tries to read the lady in the wall, but can't and starts to tear up, brilliant. Paula Prentiss is killing it as an aged woman suffering from dementia. She looks as if she has been witness or victim to some incredible horrors that she can no longer hide it. Her face speaks volumes. Her monologue about what happens to pretty things had me shook. I thought it was interesting that all the characters are named after plants. Lily, Iris, Polly, even Mr. Wisecap is the name of a mushroom. I had a little idea about how he is connected to the mold in the house, something to do with him being fungus among all these flowers, and a man in a suit killed Polly and stuck her in the wall, something about masculinity and what it does to pretty things. I may be reaching, who knows. The intense suspense is what Oz Perkins does so well. He does it just as well in The Black Cult's Daughter. He likes to juggle multiple parallel stories in both these films and how he reveals information that is able to draw the viewer in but keep them guessing. Perkins has an interesting view on loss from how he lost both his parents. His father was actor Anthony Perkins. Oz lost his dad to complications from AIDS and his mother to 9/11. In an interview, he explains why he dedicated this film to his father. I'll leave you with this. Quote, "That film was deliberately pointed at my relationship with him. I was trying to reconcile my inability to know my father. That is what the movie is about, ultimately. It's about looking for more than one can get out of a person. Looking for a deeper connection that's not really possible. I wanted to sort of give that film to my father as a continued exploration of our relationship. Just because someone isn't alive anymore doesn't mean your exploration of the relationship you have with that person doesn't continue." End quote.